my God.
Okay.
Wait.
We're on. We literally have been talking for the last minute.
Okay, first of all, stop laughing.
Okay, look who's laughing here. Because they heard us.
And David, get out of my damn stream. Okay, so look. Stars in the house. Oh, my God. There we go. We're live.
Oh, my gosh.
So let me first just say that my sister Beth emailed me. She's like, why
it's
is
your karma, by the way.
For being so haughty?
Yes.
Because, by the way, my whole family knows nothing about, I know nothing about computers, but my family knows even less.
As you clearly just showed, Seth.
So the point is, Beth was like, oh, why? She was like, why isn't the link on starsinthehouse.com? And I'm like, because the show isn't live. Learn how to use a computer. And then Margie, our producer, was like, why is the link on Stars in the House? So I realized I hadn't fed it to that. But by the way, then we started the show, right. And we're like, chatty. And then
neither one of us even noticed that these little eyeballs that here that tell us how many people were watching. And then it literally said go live, and it had not been clicked.
And it was so much me talking
about Andrew Lloyd Webber. And
so go back to the beginning.
Hi, I'm James.
Hi, I'm Seth Rudetsky. This, by the way, the opposite. I have to move this.
Well, you're confused, Seth. It's more confusing. It's opposite anyway. And then on top of it, we changed places.
We changed sides because of James's shoulder.
Yeah, I have
and into the hoop.
Anyway, go ahead. We had Andrew Lloyd Webber on.
Well, we have to see what this is.
Okay, go ahead.
So it starts in the house. It's every day at 2 p.m. and 8 p.m. For the Actors Fund. Oh, wait, it's for anyone that works in the business.
That's
and,
right.
And any aspect of the business. Ushers,
professional professionals across the country. And that's not just, I keep saying it. I'm like Dr. LaPook about the curve. I'm like, it's not just actors and who have a lot of money that are in New York and Los Angeles. We're talking about ballet companies, symphonies, basically every professional arts organization that's in your community.
And every aspect of it. So
that's
people
right.
that take the tickets, people that work the box office,
right.
people that print the programs, anyone can get help from the Actors Fund. And boy, do people need it because nobody is working.
And they're quite frankly, not to be a downer here, but the reality is we're all in danger, the arts, of losing that base and foundation. And of course, Stokes will speak much more eloquently than I will. But
yeah, you know, he's here. I forgot he's here. He knows.
He'll tell you. I mean, we're nothing without the science, without science and without the arts.
So yes, this afternoon we had Andrew Lloyd Webber celebrating his birthday. We're going to talk to an Andrew Lloyd Webber star right after this. But he was literally here. It was Sierra Boggess, Ramin, and Lord Andrew Lloyd Webber.
And Norm Lewis made a
and Norm Lewis
a guest appearance.
And I was talking to him about his crazy intervals and about writing. And he was like, the original artist who sang the role. And I was like, Judy Covington? He's like, yes, Judy Covington. Anyway, I was so much
yes.
crazy me being obsessed with him.
You were actually pretty good. You didn't cut him off. You were really close, Seth, but you didn't. I was
proud about
of
our
you.
Marriage? Me coming anyway, the point is, it was amazing seeing him. Second of all, we got to bring up, I guess we have, oh yeah. First of all, if you're watching this right now, I beg of you, share this on any platform you have because still people like don't are like, wait, what are you doing? The more people that know, the more people that will watch and just not feel isolated. And hopefully the more people that will donate to the Actors Fund. So go to Twitter, take like 2 seconds, copy the link, go to Twitter, Facebook, anything and share. That's fair.
Okay. So
donations.
We got a lot of donations. I'm going to just read.
I'm going to play some Andrew.
A few here. This is what came in at the end of the show this afternoon.
Just a couple then.
Rachel from New Jersey, $25. Taylor from Michigan, $155. Tessa from Wisconsin, $50. Rick from New York, $25. Stephen from Connecticut, $25. Eva from New York, $25. Jay from Florida, $50.
It's pronounced
Ava. I know. I realized it as soon as I said it.
It's all
I
messed good.
It up. I had the joke in my head.
Okay. So the next thing I'm looking at our little list.
Let's bring on Dr. LaPook.
Yes. And we got Dr. LaPook. We have a picture that you're going to appreciate. So here's the chief medical correspondent of Stars in the House. He also works for CBS. Yeah. But chief medical correspondent for Stars in the House, Dr. John LaPook.
America wants to know why you switched positions from 2 o'clock.
Okay. It's actually, you could actually help. Poor James dislocated his shoulder. By the way, I bought him sneakers, and he walked down the stairs. And he was carrying 2 suitcases. I told him to use
this
Savannah
is literally shirt. 10 years ago, Seth.
Anyway, dislocated it, got surgery. The shoulder is still bad. So sitting on that side was hurting his shoulder.
So I had a partial shoulder replacement on my left shoulder. And I went back to the doctor right before all of this hit, and I was going to see him again soon. But, you know, it's like it hurts, and I was supposed to maybe go back into physical therapy, but it's not worth it. So, but I'd rather not aggravate.
You can do stuff at home, right? You can do some gentle exercises at home. And
I do.
You might have something written out that you can use. But anyway, I digress.
Thank you.
Hey, Dr. LaPook.
We saw you.
Yes, we saw you on the CBS Evening News this evening. Great job.
From Kate's office, my wife's office. That's where I was broadcasting. We're doing this home broadcasting using something called LiveView, L-I-V-E-U.
And we're on StreamYard. And you were begging people, do not hoard. I may need this stupid medicine one day. Leave the damn medicine for someone who needs it right now.
Yeah, so we're seeing this right this very second, even as we speak. So you heard about hydroxychloroquine, which is also called Plaquenil. That is something that is used, and we know it works, for people with rheumatoid arthritis and things like lupus. And it may, underline may, work for people with COVID-19. Well, people are saying, well, you know what? Why don't I just have it on my cupboard, in my medicine cabinet, just in case? Well, when it's on your cabinet, in your medicine cabinet, just in case, it's not in the hospitals and it's not in the pharmacies where people need it. So already there are people who need it, who have lupus, who have rheumatoid arthritis, and they can't get it. I heard that today from somebody who tried to prescribe it. And what happens to those people is they can end up in the hospital. They end up in the hospital, they're vulnerable. They could get COVID in the hospital. They could give it to your health professionals who are taking care of them. The health professionals get sick. And now guess what? When you hoarding it at home, when you get sick and you need a health professional, they may not be there for you. So there's both a societal reason to be, you know, thinking of the community, and there's also a selfish reason.
Selfish for your own health, 100%.
Yeah. So Dr. LaPook, before we go to our first Tony Award winner of the night, wanted to share with you, can you bring it up, Seth? This is from my cousin's, my cousin sent it to me. Her son is doing distant learning, and I think they took a little words at some right here.
Remember you were saying it's really good to kind of keep things regular, even if you're not at school, just to kind of make the kid feel safe. This is our cousin's kid, Devlin, and look, when he learns in school in his house, he made his own school.
What does that say?
Swanson Elementary School. Thank you, Devlin.
Good, and he could be the principal and the vice principal and the hall monitor, everything. He could be the gym teacher.
I loved boxes when I was a kid. All right, so Dr. LaPook, by the way, I don't like gym teachers. Anyway, we're going to bring you back after we have a couple of Tony Award winners.
Okay.
Stay tuned. So, Andrew Lloyd Webber's birthday. We want to bring one of our pals, one of the most brilliant Andrew Lloyd Webber stars and Tony Award winners.
Who's coming from the place where we stayed. My gosh, 10 years ago, we stayed at this ranch.
Yeah, in her beautiful, beautiful ranch down in Texas. Please welcome Tony Award winner, the original Grizabella, Miss Betty Lynn Buckley.
Hey guys, I'm so happy to see you.
Thank you for inviting me. So this is your beautiful.
Remember when you were out here?
Yes.
Of course.
It was actually James's birthday, and your birthday is the day before, right? We had birthday cake.
I remember. And he stayed in my guest house, which now is Kathy's house.
Kathy Briganti. Hi, Kathy. So Betty, we want to just talk a little bit about Angela. We're going to bring Betty back for a whole show. Believe me, there's so many. We're going to talk about Pippin. We're going to talk about 1776, yes. But we got to talk about Andrew Lloyd Webber. Talk to me for just a little bit. One of my favorite stories that Audra's listening, I don't know if she even knows, your opening night, which you thought was going to be opening night of Cats, and it wasn't opening night and the critics, that crazy.
No. Please don't make me tell that story.
It's live, Betty.
Oh my God, it was the most horrible day. So we were rehearsing in the daytime and then doing the previews at night. And so Trevor Nunn gave us this big pep talk that I think it was like on a Wednesday or Thursday. And at the end of his talk, and he said, okay, I want you to go out. He just had us all really psyched. And he said, because tonight all the most important critics are going to be there. And I was like, what? You know, because I thought our actual opening was three nights hence or something.
And in the old days, critics used to come literally on opening night, period. When you became 1776, so you thought 3 days from all the big critics coming, they were coming 3 nights early.
I was still working my way into my performance, and it was really difficult for me to find what would please them. And the job assignment was stop the show, which I had yet. So I went through this whole process. I knew it could be done because the great Elaine Page had done just that. So I went through this whole process, but I wasn't there yet. So I was literally inconsolable, and I couldn't go out on our dinner break. And my wonderful dresser, Marcy O'Leary, was trying to console me. And I was just, I guess this was a true anxiety attack. I don't know that I've had anything comparable to that since that day. So she gets me in my unitard for my opening number. I'm just a normal cat in the opening number. Then I come back and I switch into my Grizabella dragon. So we go downstairs and I'm literally trembling with fear. I'm so adrenalized. And we get to my entrance point before Remark the Cat. And our wonderful sound guy comes running over and says, her microphone's broken. So I'm in at that point, a very expensive musical, $5 million musical, and I'm basically the girl singer in the show, and I have no microphone. And so Marcy had trained me that if there was ever anything bad, I was supposed to spread eagle, and she would take off the coat. It was like a coat with the marabou wrapped around my neck, which then became my tail, and then a little sequin dress that was a kind of a simple, tattered version of a sequin dress. And then she unzipped from the back and then down to my bodysuit, which she unzipped again. And the mic pack was at the tail, underneath the tail. And so I'm there and I'm terrified. And so she switches my mic pack out, zips me back in. I'm still waiting for my entrance music. And Dale comes running over again and he says, that mic's broken too. So that we went through the whole process a second time. And this wonderful guy, Merlin, came over, I did several shows with Merlin, 1776 and Pippin and stuff, and he sees the terror that I'm facing, and we're in the dark, and he gets right in front of me. He's like, look in my eyes, breathe. And he's like, spread them, lady, 86 precinct. He's trying to make me laugh, and I'm like, So they switch me out that time, and just before I'm to step on stage, Dale runs over again and says, that mic's broken too. So Merlin yelled at me as I'm like going out for my first entrance as Isabella. He says, go down to the foot mics and sing like you did when you were 11. So I like charged through the cats down front center. And it was that was the night Frank Rich was there. I remember his review very clearly. It was like, Betty Buckley has a strident voice. And but from that, it was like, the only unkind thing he said. I was like, strident, you'd be strident too if you didn't have a body mic and try to sing those songs. Anyway, I was like, what? So yeah, that was, thanks Seth for that
memory. Welcome. Hey Betty,
thanks for that memory, Seth.
Everybody loves you. The amount of comments you're getting, I can't even tell you what you're getting on the side. I'm going to show some of these in memory. Okay, you can talk.
Betty, how are your horses? How are your animals?
Well, they were very happy when I got home. We drove from Texas. My second week at the Carlisle was canceled, and now the whole Carlisle Hotel is shut down temporarily. And so we opted to drive because we were really worried about flying. So we rented this SUV, a large one, with all our luggage and stuff. And we thought, we're road dogs, we can handle this, because we drove from time to time on the Hello Dolly tour. Okay. So it took us 3.5 days. It was like the slow, we were taking it slow anyway. Yeah. But it was like, see America shut down. That was basically the whole thing.
So two things I want to say. First of all, Betty, you were welcome on Hello Dolly in Pittsburgh. You had us in the palm of your hand. I agree. We saw Betty twice.
Yep, we saw you in LA and DC.
Second of all, I want to play this so all the divas watching, including Stokes and Audra, hear this brilliance. This is you doing memory, and not only is your E pure eval, but you literally do the entire phrase in one breath. I was listening to you and having a breakdown. You got to listen to this, Betty. It's one breath and listen to the evals. It's incredible. Okay, here we go. Audra?
Come on, Betty. I mean,
what are you doing?
Thanks for the rest of us, for God's sake. That's incredible.
Thank you. Thank you.
I've always bowed to you, but
you're too kind. You're very kind. Those were the days. Remember when we did that duet of Anita and Maria at that concert?
Gosh, at that concert. It was like a school auditorium or something. It was very strange.
It was somewhere in Jersey, and it was like, you were very young and beautiful, and I was so intimidated. But anyway, do you remember that? I watched you last night on the Rosie thing, you and Will. That was beautiful.
Oh, thank you. We had no idea that Patti LuPone had sung the number before.
It was cool to hear it twice. I liked it. And I love that guitar version.
Yeah, so, no, we had no idea. We were literally running around after the baby. And then it was like, your call time is this. We ran and sat down like, here's our number. And then afterwards, everybody's texting us going, Patti just sang that, you idiot.
No, it was great. I love your tweets about your little girl. Those are some of my favorites. I'm always retweeting what you tweet on.
And I follow you too. I followed your road trip across the country. I'm glad you guys got home safely. Thanks. I had to do that cross country drive after 9/11.
Yeah.
So I was thinking about you and empathizing, and especially driving across the country and seeing the country shutting down as you're doing it.
And there was no, like, restaurants were closing, and you know, it was weird. We could only get takeout and stuff like that.
Yeah. But you made it. You're home.
Yeah, we did. We went into every hotel room with our Lysol spraying everything. And
exactly. Spray down. So, Betty Buckley, you're going to come back for a full show. So I'm saying goodbye to you. Keep watching, but you're coming back for a full show.
You asked me to get all this stuff. I got all this stuff.
I don't want to put you on the spot. Hold on. Audra, peace out. Okay, so wait. What do we have?
Okay, so my friend, Carol Richards Bernstein, she's married to Ira Bernstein, who used to be the general manager, because she sent me this great stuff. This is like some of the Christmas lights from the original Cats production. And then there's individual ones too. There's like three individual ones. There's one big package like this. There's, you asked me to do this, so
yeah, I did. No, this is, I didn't know if you had any.
These postcards of the original production on Broadway that are really quite beautiful. I have like three or four of those. And then there's these programs from the original production. And then this is really cool. This is like an actual piece of the Heaviside Layer that I went up on on the crane every night, you know. So that's from the actual floor. And it says, Heaviside Layer from the set of Cats, the longest running show in Broadway history.
Oh my God, I'll just start bidding. Okay, so
let's just- there's one more thing.
What?
And then,
Cats?
This is my original, when I'm in the opening number, my original wig I wore as a normal cat.
My gosh.
Stokes, look at that. Who's gonna start? This is all for the Actors Fund, people.
That's amazing. Betty, thank you so much for doing that. I mean, it's incredible. Yeah. People are coming out of the woodwork to help out. And thank you so much. And man, listen,
yes.
You know how much I love you.
Oh, some stuff. So here it is. I found all this stuff.
Well, we just didn't know it was going to be like in a complete Cats package, Betty. That's amazing.
Here's like a photo of the final performance, September 10th, 2000.
This is amazing. So it's going to be a nice package.
There's these little cards of me as Grisabella at that final performance. I mean, I was at the final performance, not as Grisabella.
Yes, ma'am. Anyway.
So we could sell it all at a piece, or we could sell it in
the I have a big old Cats package.
Will you sign it? Yeah, will you sign it, Betty?
Yeah, of course, I'll sign everything.
Okay, so listen, so you have to email starsinthehouse2020@gmail.com. Yesterday, Adam Berry was bidding, not surprising, Betty. So everyone start bidding. Go starsinthehouse2020@gmail.com for Betty's cat swag.
Right, because the staff from Into the Woods is over $1,000. We're still, you know, we don't want to overwhelm the Actors Fund folks. So we're kind of
figuring it out,
like if we're going to have a separate website. So for now, starsinthehouse2020@gmail. We have volunteers that are checking the email and seeing which one's the highest bid. Betty, I say we follow, everyone's example, and let's like give it a week and see if people tune in, because some people watch it not live.
And take a photo, Betty. Take a photo with some of this stuff. We're going to post it, okay?
Yeah, and send it.
Okay, and so send it to you guys.
Is that Thank you, lady. All right.
Do I send it to you?
Yes.
Yeah, email it to me. All right, bye, Betty. Great seeing you.
I love what you guys are doing. Thank you.
Thank you, Lynn.
I love you. Bye.
Stress in the House. Okay, there you go. Let us bring up our first, our second Tony Award winner. God, old school Mr. Brian Stokes. Wait a minute.
Oh my gosh. Is that like your Trapper John days, Stokes?
This was my first photo ever, my resume photo. I think I was 16 years old.
I want to be on that.
You can. I was like 16 years old when I did this. You know, it's like my how we devolve. Huh? It's like, oh my God.
She needs to cut. Mitchell, I don't know how you're doing it. Right now, you are the chairman of the board of the Actors Fund. What is it like in the trenches, man?
Well, this is how I'm doing it. I'm doing it because I'm not really doing it. What's amazing about the Actors Fund and about our entertainment community is that we have always been collaborators. It's amazing to me. You can't put on a show without collaboration. It absolutely demands that. You have lighting designers, you have costume designers, you have ticket takers, you have curtain pullers, you have the ushers, you have the actors, you have the musicians in the pit, you have dancers, you have singers, you have, of course, actors as well. But that's what everybody always sees. But we can't do it without everybody else. And it's always been this amazing collaboration. And I am blown away by this collaboration. That first, you guys, thank you so much, you know, for making this, starting this all, making this happen. You're making a ton of money for the Actors Fund. That's why this says Stokes the Grateful. I am so grateful for you. Rosie's show yesterday as well, she made more money, and all the people that have been a part of this. It's always been about our entertainment community coming together and helping each other. And really, I can't take credit. It's Joe Ben and Casa, the incredible staff at the fund. It's the volunteers. It's the medical people there. There are so many people that are this. And anybody who is giving to this becomes kind of by extension, a part of that as well. So I'm just really, really grateful to everybody who's made this all happen, and the folks that are watching this fantastic show. The show this afternoon was great too. Oh my God. It was great.
There's so much music that's going to happen. Let's just start with the music right now. Then we're going to go back to chatting. So you're a brilliant musician. Are you going to play for yourself, track it? What's happening?
So this is a track from the album that I just finished. It came out the end of last year, and it's called Plays,
so much.
Plays with Music. And we'll show that again later. Thank you. Oh, look at you. You're all fancy. I was thinking, what's the best song to sing in gratitude to all of the people that have been just, you know, really coming together and pulling it together? And I thought, oh, it's just so obvious. The opening song on my album is this incredible salute to everybody in show business. And I did this. It's not the usual arrangement, though. My second brain, musical brain, Ted Firth, and I got together, and we thought, you know, I want to do some fun with this. Let's make this odd meters. And I heard Sir Andrew talking about how he loves odd meters. Me too. Love odd meters. Every one of my solo albums has odd meters on them. And I thought, you know, I wanted to kind of say, show business is fun and great and wonderful, but it's also kind of sideways. It's a little bit quirky. It's a little bit odd as well. So I challenge you, Seth and James, to when you hear an odd meter, count it out on your fingers and see what you hear. And so this is to everybody. Thank you so much who's been helping out the Actors Fund. I dedicate this to all of you. Let me see if I can make my technology work now. Let's see, and here we go. I'm getting the wheel of death, but it will start. The butcher, the baker, the grocer, the clerk are secretly unhappy men because the butcher, the baker, the grocer, the clerk get paid for what they do, but no applause. They gladly bid their dreary jobs goodbye. For anything theatrical, and why? There's no business like show business, like no business I know. Everything about it is appealing. Everything the traffic will allow. Nowhere could you get that happy feeling when you are stealing that extra bow. There's no people like show people, they smile when they are low. Even with a turkey that you know will fold, you may be stranded out in the cold. Still, you wouldn't change it for a sack of gold. Let's go on with the show. The costumes, the scenery, the makeup, the props, the audience that lifts you when you're down. The headaches, the heartaches, the backaches, the flops, the sheriff who escorts you out of town. The opening when your heart beats like a drum. The closing when the customers won't come. There's no business like show business, like no business I know. You get word before the show has started that your favorite uncle died at dawn. Topper, that your pa and ma have parted. You're broken-hearted, but you go on. There's no people like show people, they don't run out of dough. Angels come from everywhere with lots of jack, and when you lose it, there's no attack. Where can you get money that you don't give back? Let's go on with the show. There's no business like show business, like no business I know. Traveling through the country is so thrilling. Standing out in front on opening nights, smiling as you watch the theater filling, and as you're billing up there in the lights. There's no people like show people, they smile when they are alone. Yesterday they told you you would not go far. That night you opened and there you are. Next day on your dressing room they've hung a star. Let's go on with the show. Let's go on with the show.
That I got. Yes!
Thank you, thank you, guys. Awesome. Oh my God! Thank you. Arrangement is outstanding.
Thank you, thank you.
Fantastic.
What is that? Is that loser? Is that what you're doing?
No, I was trying to come up.
Like, you're fired. Hey, here's
I love you guys. Thank you. Thanks, Audra. Thanks. Thanks, Betty. Thank you guys so
much. He's our Actors Fund doctor, Jason Kent. No one is better than Stokes, and we agree. I mean, the comments.
You know what? Can I say nobody is better than Jason Kent? I was talking to him today, and you know, I needed some advice too. So, and of course, he's one of the regulars on this show as well. And I gave him a call, and he said, "Here's what you do. Here's, you know, don't worry about that. Do this. Do this. Do this." And I feel so much better now just from talking to him. And we're just grateful to him and all of the healthcare workers right now that are on the front lines of this pandemic. So thank you, Dr. Jason.
He's coming on the show Friday night. So
great. Great. So
we're going to bring up your pal, Audra Ann McDonald. Hi, Auds.
Hi. So, I mean, I was literally trying to call on my Juilliard training to catch all the time signatures, and then I realized that I basically almost and, you know, intents and purposes, I did flunk out of Juilliard, so I couldn't figure it out. That's what I was like trying to do. Is it a three or is it four? Or, yeah.
We got to be honest. Okay, so just talk for 2 seconds about during ragtime together. Did you guys have to audition together or were you just cast separately?
Do you want to start, Audra Mac?
I don't remember any of my life, really. So. The show was written with you in mind, right?
Yeah. Sort of, kind of, yeah. So, yeah, finish your story, though, and I'll tell mine.
My story is that I don't remember anything.
I guess it's my turn.
No, I mean, I didn't audition, but I got asked to do that first workshop.
Yeah.
You did the workshop with Stokes. You did it with Stokes.
We flew up together in to Toronto.
I remember the first time I met you, Audra Mac, you were sitting in the seat behind me and you were there with your teddy bear. And I thought,
Maria.
I'm pretty sure that's Audra McDonald. And I want to say hi now. And I remember reaching over the back of the seat.
Yes, I do remember that.
Yeah.
What I remember is that we were all filling out our little landing cards. And I remember for some reason you checked off one thing. And it was like, if you're bringing in agriculture or pets or anything, or animals or anything like that. And I was like, you marked that wrong. You were like, no, my dog is with me. It wasn't Diggity, but it was
Max the dog.
That's right.
Oh, yeah, Max the dog. Yeah, he was with me for that whole journey. It was pretty.
1996? Five? Yeah. 96, something like that.
That was, yeah, 22 years ago now. When I started, Garth Drabinsky, I was doing Kiss of the Spider Woman. I'd been doing that show for like 2.5 years at that point. And Garth Drabinsky kept coming to me during the run of the show, and he would say, "I got a role for you. I got something I want you to do." I said, "Well, what is it?" He said, "I can't tell you yet. I don't have the rights." I said, "Oh, okay. Well, tell me when you can." And then he would come back every few months. I still got that role. I still want you to do it. So what is it? I still can't tell you. So this went on for a while, and finally, he said, "All right, I can tell you now. The show is Ragtime. And the role is Cole House Walker Jr. And I want you to do that role." And I listened to him. I said, I think I said, "Wow, Garth, I love that movie. I love the book. Thank you so much. That blows me away. Thank you so much. Let's talk more about this and see where we go with this." And inside of my mind, I am so wrong for that role. What? Cole House Walker? You got to be kidding. I mean, now I got to say, I do that with almost every role I've ever played. I'm so wrong for that role. And so I'm glad we got to do it in workshop. But I don't know about you, Audra Mac. I think of all the shows that I've done, I always say Ragtime is the most magical show that I've ever done. And the very first piano, play the piano riff, Seth, that you hear at the beginning of the show. Yeah, and Stephen Flaherty, who wrote that with Lynn Ahrens, did the lyrics. That was there from the very first workshop we did when we were sitting around the table. Remember that? Mm-hmm. And I remember when Stephen was sitting at the piano and he played that, it felt like something huge descended on the room. And it was like, oh my God, what is that? Yeah. And it's something that never, ever left the show. And it's interesting because, you know, I've been saying lately, you know, occasionally, there are times in my life that I have felt very fortunate that, that was one of them that I felt this. I think this is one of the reasons I'm here on the planet. Yeah. I think this is why I'm supposed to be here, is to do this show. And I could tell you on another, the amazing letters I would get from people. That's another thing to talk about. But it's so interesting because just thinking about what's going on and seeing everybody coming together, you know, and I started thinking, you know what? I think this is one of the reasons maybe I'm on the planet, and you guys too, and Audra too, and everybody that's been a part of the show and seeing it and contributing to it. And, you know, I think it's why we're all here together at this time. There's something going on the planet, This is our opportunity as artists to kind of lift people up. Booker T. Washington, who was a character in the show, used to talk about the concept of crabs in a barrel. And he said, you know, it's terrible because people often are like crabs in a barrel. When one crab's trying to get out, all the other crabs are there at the bottom trying to pull it back down again. Mm-hmm. This is an opportunity for all of us to be at the top of the barrel and to reach down, a hand, a claw, whatever you want to call it, and help others up. Yeah. So I really feel that it's true, I think, for all of us. And we're going to really find our purpose here. And especially, I think, It's even true for the Actors Fund. We've been around for 138 years. And it almost feels like those 138 years of putting people together, healing people, fixing people, connecting our unions, connecting all these disparate skills, talents, crafts that make up film, television, symphony, all of those things. We've been that organization that has been kind of gluing everybody together. And it feels to me now, you know what? I think maybe this is the reason that the Actors Fund is here in this very moment as well. So yeah. I just hope other people will embrace that and help some people out of the barrel.
I feel you're right, and I feel that they are. I feel that everybody is realizing that we have to rise to the occasion in this moment and dig deep and then lift each other all up through this. It's interesting too. I you see all these sort of memes going around. I've seen memes that say things like, you know, Mother Nature's put us all on a timeout. To say, you know, now you think about what you're doing. But there is something that's been kind of uplifting to me to see as we all kind of go into our isolation and sort of starting to heal itself in a way or something. I mean, like with the pollution and animals returning to areas they weren't before. I'm wondering if there's some, I don't know, I'm just wondering if there's some sort of, maybe we needed to be still for a minute so Mother Nature could say, hey, come on. I don't know. I don't know where I'm going with that. Namaste. I don't
know. I would agree. You know, it certainly is, you know, a lesson that we cannot avoid seeing now, you know, and that's the thing. I think we've gotten those lessons are all around us because other people, Kayla and I were talking about that the other day when she was on your show, and after the show, we were talking on the phone. Right. And she was saying, I've always felt that. And now I think it's kind of in everybody's face. So I think you're right about that. And it's a tough lesson to learn, but we can't avoid it at this point. And that's maybe one of the positives that are going to come out of this.
Please, God. Audra McDonald, I always got to go back to the comedy. Can you please ask Stokes if he remembers that time you were doing the end of Act One and they lifted you with the... Yeah, I got to know his version of the story. Please, thank you.
Wait, do you remember this, Stokes?
What's his story?
Okay, so one night, you know, when I would get beaten to death every night, you remember that in
good yes, time. I do, yeah.
And the police officers beat me up, and then the coal house men would come in and raise me up off of the ground and then walk me off stage. And then that's when you would, that's right, because you would come on and go, no, and you'd hold me, and then they'd come in and raise me up and then walk me off stage, right? And so do you remember the night that they all came in, you were holding me, no, and then they came in and they raised me up, and one of the guys, I don't know if it was Bernard Dotson or which one of them lifted me up, and his microphone got stuck to my wig. He raised me up, my wig went. No, Sarah had a bad wig. Sarah's bald too.
Go on, I'll look at that and go, nice. wait a second.
And cut.
Oh,
Audra, you had an announcement about an item that you were going to donate, right?
Yes. First of all, after admitting on your show a couple days ago that I had kept the babies from Ragtime, Marty Bell, one of our producers of the show, wrote us a note saying, saw you guys on the show, it's all great, and I'll be sending you a bill for the props. Wait, yeah. Sally was playing with this yesterday, and she kept saying, she's so beautiful. And I said, this is a boy. This is Cole House Walker the third, right? Because you're Cole House.
Yes, yes.
And she kept saying, no, this is a girl. And I said, no, it's a boy. And then I showed her can you see this? The feet.
You see there you go.
And she said, is it chocolate? I was like, no. Anyway, so I have, this is the Wheels of a Dream baby, but I also have the baby from that was buried in the ground. I have that one too. And I can't part with both of them, but I am willing to part with one to auction off anybody who wants to buy a 22-year-old baby. I will more than happy to auction this off. Wow. All the money would go to the Actors Fund. So
amazing. You email right there and you'll go with Betty. Betty, of course, has her cat's paraphernalia. You can add to that, Betty.
That's terrific.
The baby. Okay, so we got to bring on Dr. LaPook and then we're going to go back.
I have a question about that baby later on after Dr. LaPook.
Please remember.
Hold on, Stokes. Yeah. Here's both you and Audra. Here's the first batch of just a few.
Hold on. I'm sorry. Someone's warning you. Oh my God. Please, you know, don't auction them.
Okay. Yeah, the baby's ready. Baby needs to leave home. 22 years old. This baby needs to leave home. That's hilarious. That's
funny. You got it? Okay. So we have George from California donated $310.
Thank Ulysses. You, George.
Thank you.
Yes. Man. Ulysses from Texas, $103. Wow. Riley from New York, $50. Bethany from Pennsylvania, $25. George from Michigan, $155. Wow. Judy from Illinois, $100. How would you pronounce it? So.
Oh, wow. Vinci.
From California, $15. And Aaron from Massachusetts, $100.
It's amazing. Oh, thank you guys so much.
Thank you guys so much. Thank you.
So far, we've raised we only started last Monday night. We've raised more than $80,000 so far.
That is so incredible, you guys. That's what, you know, it's a look at this wonderful collaboration you have created here. Yeah. Thank you so much.
It's Broadway. All right, we gotta bring on our doctor. Well, you know, it's the arts. Broadly, everyone, we all work together.
We have high expectations that everyone is going to just participate have fun and sing and have a good time.
No one puts on makeup. And everyone says yes.
Is that an insult?
Well, Audra asked if she had to wash her hair. The answer was yes.
I did wash it finally. I'm sorry. Sorry. Hello, Dr. LaPook.
Hi, Dr. LaPook. How are you?
I've been saying that you're the spoonful of sugar and I'm the medicine. So this is a little bit more serious, but there's something that's bubbling up literally today that I want to let everybody know about because I think it's going to be confusing to everybody. You're seeing two forces brushing against each other right now. One force is social distancing, keep away from each other, stay home kind of thing. We got to bend the curve because the number one thing is to decrease the pressure on the healthcare system, flatten out the curve. We don't want the healthcare system to crack and for people to not get the care they need. The other thing that we're seeing, and the other force, is how long can we do this for? The economy's collapsing or the stock market's crashing. People are out of work. Of course, that can lead to its own problems, physical problems. People not being able to get enough money to eat, to pay their rent and all that. And that can lead to illness. So you're starting to see this brush up against each other. And there's something that hasn't gotten a lot of discussion, but I want to put it out there now for everybody to be looking for this. And I want to put pressure on the powers that be to figure this out. There are two types of testing. One is the testing you put in your nose and the back of your throat. That's the PCR. It tells you whether you have the virus right now. The other type of testing is the blood test. It's called serologic testing. It's looking for antibodies to the coronavirus that's causing this, okay? There's two types of antibodies, not to get too technical, but one is IgM, it means you've had a recent infection. One is IgG, you've had a past infection. You've gotten this all the time. Any woman who's gotten pregnant had an MMR. They want measles, mumps, rubella. You don't want to have German. You want to make sure you're immune to German measles, which is rubella. Any healthcare worker who's been in a hospital has been tested for measles. You can't be not immune to measles and then go work and spread the measles. So this will tell you if you had it. Why is that important? It's important because we think that, you know, you've heard the symptoms could be no symptoms to the sniffles, allergy-like symptoms, 50% or so, about 50% can have GI symptoms, diarrhea, nausea, abdominal discomfort. We're finding more and more loss of smell now seems to be a new symptom. So there are all these types of symptoms all the way to so severe that you're on the verge of death with bad pneumonia. So if we can ramp up this serologic testing, which they're working on right now, we can find out who has been exposed already. And presumably, unless this is acting differently than every other virus or most every other virus we know, you should be immune for at least a few years. And those are the people we can send back to work, to the front lines, to man the places in the hospital, find out who's been infected and get them out there. And it's very frustrating to not have this data right now, because I think it could really be a solution to that brushing up of these two forces.
Is there anything we can do to...
How good are you at biochemistry and molecular biology? No, for everybody out there, I think what we can do is we can start...
Who does that? Someone's moving papers near my.
But I talked about it on the evening news tonight about the testing. I think we just got to talk about it and put the pressure on it. You know, we've seen an amazing response from, I know they take a lot of knocks, but industry. Our industry is talking about changing gears and literally and figuratively and creating ventilators. You're talking about companies that are making many more masks. You're talking about scientific places like the Broad Institute that used to be doing this type of work, and now they're going to switch to COVID. There are so many great minds all over the world that are working on this, and I'd love to see them work on this issue and ramp up so that there can be millions of people tested. I think it's going to really help us get from here to there.
We have a question from a viewer.
And this is actually very similar to one that a good friend of mine from Texas is worried about regarding her I think we have to take them off.
We re-social distancing. I told my mom she should cancel the cleaning lady, but what about a home health aide? Does an aide need to be 6 feet away from a client?
So my friend, Dr. LaPook, who is in Texas, and her grandmother's in her mid-90s, and her health just started declining about a year ago. And so now a home health aide comes every day, and she's really worried about her grandmother getting sick.
Called being between a rock and a hard place, right? She can't be alone. She has to have some help. The CDC, I actually checked with them today about this to be sure, because I was going to be talking about it on the CBS Evening News with Nora O'Donnell. Mm-hmm. And we were actually chatting. And the question was, can people go outside? And it's not all that dissimilar, because the question is, how do you get it? So the CDC is saying now, assume everybody has it. So assume that healthcare has it, because you don't know where they've been, are they with other people? So assume they have it. Close contact is considered within 6 feet, because the idea is if you cough or sneeze, the droplet can go into your mouth, nose, or eye. You have to try to stay at least that distance. If you're walking by somebody in the park, because this came up today, actually Nora asked me this, what's close contact? Because in New York City, it's hard to be 6 feet away from everybody all the time. But the CDC says, look, and the Department of Health said the same thing to me yesterday of New York State, if you're just walking by each other quickly and you happen to be 3 feet away, that's not considered close contact. Close contact is within 6 feet for what they call a prolonged period of time. What's that? We haven't nailed that down yet, but it would certainly be if you're in an edit room with somebody for 45 minutes and, you're 4 feet apart. So I think the answer to that person is she can't be alone, right? She has to have some help. And I think you try to have that person educated as much as possible that have they been in contact with anybody who's sick? Are they sick? Do they have any symptoms? And by the way, and we're saying this now to everybody who is thinking of going to work or being with other people, you have to feel perfectly fine before you go out and have this any kind of close contact with anybody. Actually, you should try to keep your distance anyway. But you should be staying home if you don't feel perfectly fine. And I know that's hard, because you have millions of people who have diarrhea. It's allergy season. It's cold and flu season. So what's COVID and what's just stuff that half the country has? But I think right now, when we're trying to flatten that curve, we have to be cautious. We have to stay home.
And it's for limited. It's for a limited time. That's what.
And then that's why I think I go back to that testing. We are here. I'm gonna go listen to your heart, Audra, or Brian. I don't have a stethoscope, and you're in another country. I can't do it. Okay. Right. I want to know if you have COVID or if you have this new coronavirus. I can't do it without the tools, because the clinical stuff that normally you get a sense as a doctor. Okay, you have this and you have this and. The hairs on the back of my neck are standing up. So there's a little science, there's a little intuition. And I think it's this. It's almost out the window when you're talking about symptoms that are so wide. That said, if somebody has cough, fever, shortness of breath, you have to assume that they have COVID. And that person may need to, if they have shortness of breath, they need to be seen and evaluated. But don't just walk into an emergency room or a doctor's office. because you can infect them. Call ahead and give them a warning to get geared up. And if you don't have a health professional, you can call the emergency room. You can also call your local Department of Health or the State Department of Health. There are hotlines. You can call them and get direction.
I'm sorry. Can I ask a quick question?
Yeah. Of course.
You know, we're all sheltering in place. I'm sheltering in place with my family and everything, but we've determined that I'm the one that goes out when it's time to go get groceries and things like that. So I go out with my gloves on. I don't have a mask. I do go out with my gloves and my Clorox wipes. Mm-hmm. And I mean, you know, as I'm walking by people in the grocery store and whatnot, I mean, I'm already seeing people starting to more than before keep their distance and whatnot. What's the safest way to go about doing that? Because that's the one thing we have to do.
You have to go out. And I think just understanding the biology of it is what helps. Okay. So if somebody's not within 6 feet of you, they're not going to give you, the likelihood there is they're not going to give it to you. There's this asterisk. We talk about aerosolization. Yes. Put that aside. Okay. Mm-hmm. And if they're not within 6 feet of you and they're not coughing and sneezing, you're not going to get it that way. Surfaces, definitely the big question mark here. How long can it survive? It could be a day, it could be a few days. So, and we all touch our face 23 times an hour by this one Australian study where they videotaped medical students. Mm-hmm. So try to keep your hands in your pockets, below your chin, wash your hands frequently for 20 seconds. And when you go out for that shopping, those hands don't go above your chin. If you could ever try to do that, it's when you're shopping, because who knows, you know, you're on a shelf and you go to get the cereal and your hand brushes against a place where somebody else did. And you have to think that with that degree of paranoia, you don't want to go down the rabbit hole. You don't want to go nuts with it. But I think if you can just understand that if your hands are full of virus, but they're not in your mouth, nose or eyes, there's plenty of time. Just wash them off. So that's the thing. You know, try if you're a nail biter, a cuticle biter, this is never a better time to stop.
Yeah. Okay. This is good to know. Yeah. No, I mean, I do it with gloves and I have the Clorox wipes and I wipe down everything before I, you know, get in the car and all that stuff. But I was, you know, I'm sure I'm being super paranoid, but I was just curious as to what's the safest way.
Yeah. And if people out there don't have gloves, you know, remember that your hands themselves, if they have the virus on it, as long as you wash for 20 seconds, soap dissolves away the lipid membrane, that fatty membrane. It's really effective. And just get the tips of your fingers, the knuckles, the hand, all those things. Oh, and the thing that I learned about 10 years ago, I got this wrong on an annual hospital test. They do it and I say, oh, I have to do this again. I know all this. I learned something, which was I was doing Purell wrong. So the way to do it the right way is you put it in sort of the well of your hand. People forget their fingertips. And they actually showed this in some great study where they had a special light after people used it, and then the tips all lit up with the dirt, with the schmutz. So you put your finger, you put it in the middle of your, I'll put it high enough. You put your fingers in there, you flip it over your fingers in there, and then you do every single millimeter of your hand. Wow. I was doing it wrong. I was missing the tips of it. That's so anyway.
Good to know. Thank you.
Very Achilles heel. All right, Dr. LePoog, you're going to come back and say goodbye later. Don't go nowhere. Bryce Hitch Mitchell, we need a music break. What the hell are you going to give us? I can't wait. And what meter? Hold on. You're muted.
You're muted, Stokes.
Yep. Hold on.
Now, that was my paper.
So, what the hell?
That's why I muted. Yeah, it's on the computer where it is. I'm going to do this. I don't think it has any crazy. Can you hear me?
Yes.
We can hear you now.
This doesn't have any crazy meters on it, but you know, since we're all stuck in the house and everything, I thought it would be fun to do a song where I can do this song and do all of the characters without having any social distancing, because I just get to play all the characters. This is another one from my album. And after this, let's talk about what I mentioned to you earlier too, Seth, after I do the song as well. And so this is a song I think.
Papers move again. Huh? Stop touching your damn papers.
Oh, okay, hold on. Let me get these things out of the way, because I don't know where the mic is on this thing. Okay. Is it better?
What am I supposed to do?
Oh, I'm sorry. I suck. All right. I'm sorry. Okay.
You can hear it. It's static.
Is that better? Or is everybody happy now?
Okay. We're fine now. Bye. Okay.
All right. Here we go. Let's see. Now, my computer has to spool up every time I do this. It goes on rest, and then I have to wait for it to. Let's see. It's going to start up. Anytime soon. Talk amongst yourselves. Mm.
Yes, this day, pinnacle of life, husband joined wife, the heart leaps up to behold this golden day. Today is for Amy. Amy, I give you the rest of my life to cherish and to keep you, to honor you forever. Today is for Amy. My happily soon to be wife.
Pardon me, is everybody here? Because if everybody's here, I'd like to thank you all for coming to the wedding. I'd appreciate your going even more. I mean, you must have lots of better things to do, and not a word of it to Paul. Remember, Paul, you know the man I'm going to marry, but I'm not, because I wouldn't ruin anyone as wonderful as he is. Thank you all for the gifts and the flowers. Thank you all. Now it's back to the showers. Don't tell Paul, but I'm not getting married today.
Blessed this day, tragedy of life, husband yoked to wife, the heart sinks down and feels dead, this dreadful day.
Listen, everybody, look, I don't know what you're waiting for. A wedding, what's a wedding? It's a prehistoric ritual where everybody promises fidelity forever, which is maybe the most horrifying word I've ever heard, and which is followed by a honeymoon where suddenly he'll realize he's saddled with a nut and want to kill me, which he should. Thanks a bunch, but I'm not getting married. Go have lunch, because I'm not getting married. You've been grand, but I'm not getting married. Don't just stand there, I'm not getting married. And don't tell Paul, but I'm not getting married today. Go, can't you go? Why is nobody listening? Goodbye, go and cry at another person's wake. If you're quick for a kick, you could pick up a christening. So please, on my knees, there's a human life at stake. Listen, everybody, I'm afraid you didn't hear. Do you want to see a crazy lady falling apart in front of you? It isn't only Paul who may be ruining his life. You know, both of us be losing our identities. I telephoned my analyst about it, and he said to see him money, but by Monday I'll be floating in the Hudson with the other garbage. I'm not well, so I'm not getting married. You've been swell, but I'm not getting married. Clear the hole, because I'm not getting married. Thank you all, but I'm not getting married. And don't tell Paul, but I'm not getting married today. Go, can't you go? Look, you know I adore you all, but why? Watch me die like Eliza on the ice. Look, perhaps I'll collapse in the apse right before you all. So take back the cake, burn the shoes, and boil the rice. Look, I didn't want to have to tell you, but I may be coming down with hepatitis, and I think I'm going to faint. So if you want to see me faint, I'll do it happily. But wouldn't it be funnier to go and watch a funeral? So thank you for the 27 dinner plates, 37 butter knives, 47 paperweights, 57 candle holders. One more thing. I am not getting married. Softly said, I am not getting married with this ring. See, I'm not getting married. Heidi went, no, I'm not getting married. Let us pray that I'm not getting married today.
Wait, the direction at the end was amazing. Betty's loving it.
Oh my God, oh my God. It's the most impossible song ever. That's amazing.
Wow, we're
the mere idea of it like frightens the hell out of me. Anyone who takes that, it was amazing, but the ending was out of this world. Oh my
God. Thanks, Betty. Have you done that song, Betty?
No way!
Have you done it, Audra Mac? Have you ever done that?
I can't talk that fast, and I can't think that fast. It's like, I'm there. I can do that.
I can't think that fast either. You know, that's a song that I learned, and I think this is probably everybody that's done it. It just becomes muscle memory. You just have to do it and do it and do it and do it. And you, if I think about it at all, it always messes me up in the song, so.
I can't even imagine it. The mere idea, the fear of going up in a song like that would freak me out so bad.
I've done it.
I couldn't bear the adrenaline just to like take it on. I couldn't bear it. That was amazing.
Thank you.
And especially in this day of social distancing for you to do that ending was really like encouraging us all to go back to social distancing.
Right.
Don't tell everybody about your album. What you gonna do?
So yeah, my album. Well, you got it online there. Thank you so much. Today, you know, I've been trying because looking at everybody, Betty like you and Audra like you, everybody wants to auction things off, you know. And I was thinking, what else can we do? And what I decided to do is I called up Van Dean, who is the chairman and CEO of Broadway Records, and I said, Van, I got an idea. This is something that I would really much, very much like to do. Can we make this happen? And he said yes. So I said, great, let's do it. Here's what I'm going to do with the album. It plays with music. I am going to donate all of the profits from this album from the time it came out, which is last year, until we get through this. All the profits from this album are going to go to the Actors Fund. And I think it's just one way to say thank you to all of the people who are just doing so much, coming out of the woodwork to help. So if you go on BroadwayRecords.com on their website, that's where to go to buy the album. And when you do, then those profits from that album are going to go to help the Actors Fund as well.
Amazing, Stokes. Amazing.
That's awesome, Stokes.
Thank you.
You'll be happy to hear this. Speaking of money for the Actors Fund, another batch of numbers here. Thomas from New York, $255.
Thank you.
Thomas, thank you.
Florida, $25.
Thank you.
Derek from Massachusetts, $25. Amazing. Carla from California, $100. Andrea from New York, $25. Amanda from Maryland, $50. Linda from Maryland, $50. Mark from Virginia, $100. Brett from Pennsylvania, $50. And Amy from Connecticut, $100. Thank you.
Amazing. Thank you all.
It's that stuff. And don't forget, okay, so one more thing I want to just say. Dr. LaPoo keeps saying we've got to keep in touch with our friends. Social isolation is really bad. He says, think of three people you want to FaceTime or call when this is over. So we saved you the trouble, and we actually FaceTimed one of your pals. Say hi to Miss Kelly O'Hara.
She was the first guest on your show on the Stars in the House. Kelly, thank you so much. And you keep showing up always. Thank you so much.
I'm so happy. And I'm so happy to be the friend that you that he called so that I could be on the same thing as you guys.
I want a screenshot. Seth, screenshot this.
Let me see if I can. I'm going to screenshot it right now.
Oh, yeah. Oh, see now. Smile.
Oh, that's it. Yeah. Okay, I got it.
Awesome. Send that to us, Kelly.
You're such nerds. I love it.
I'm gonna text it right now. Okay.
Fabulous. How are you, baby?
I'm good. My husband said, "Who's that in the at the bottom? Because you look like you're 18 years old." I'm not kidding. You do not. You look like a tiny little child.
Oh, you're hilarious. Tell your husband I love him. No, I'm going to be 50 in July. 50. Seth, you should talk.
How about this? I control the screen. Very kind. I have the three of you guys here. Is there any possible update on the Ragtime concert? Even if it's canceled, will it be some other time? What's the deal?
It looks like it's most likely going to be moved forward. You know, from what we're hearing from everybody, we're going to kind of be in the middle of everything, maybe in 40 days from now or so. And, you know, I don't think that's enough time. Like Dr. LaPook was saying, there may be it get to be a place where, you know, if you're going to show up at a public place, maybe we'll get some kind of something saying we're clear, we've had it before, and you're safe to go in other areas. But I think there's always going to be that threat of it. So to be on the safe side, I think I'm 99.999% sure we will be moving this forward to another date. I'm grateful for all the people we were sold out. And we're also trying to make it available to more people to see, maybe with Broadway HD or something like that, because I know there's so many people that want to see this particular production.
So let me ask you, like, if it's canceled, maybe you guys can all come back that night and maybe we could do sort of a mock version of it, at least, where we could all sing a little something from it. Would that be possible?
That's, you know, anything is possible. And especially when you look with those twittering, twinkling eyes.
Well, I'm only 30.
Well, and by the way, it was sold out. We didn't even have a chance to buy tickets. So we weren't even going to be able to go as much as we wanted to go.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Well, this is why this show and what you're doing right now is so important. We also had to cancel our gala, which was happening on April 6th. And the gala and that ragtime concerts were two gigantic ways for the Actors Fund to make some money so that we can help people out. And we've lost both of those. But thanks to, you know, the cleverness and creativity of folks like you guys, Seth and James and everybody, that's Audra Mac and Betty and Kelly and everybody, and Rosie did yesterday, and Dr. John LaPook, man, it's just so great to have you part of this as well. You know, we're making something happen. You're making huge inroads. So thank you so much.
Okay, so Kelly Harrod, you're gonna come back. I wanna just, Betty Buckley had a question.
Come back another time.
Come back another time.
Yes. Have a good night.
So, yeah, man. See ya. Bye.
See ya, Kip.
She dies. Okay, so I want to just ask Betty Buckley a question for Dr. LaPook before we go. So there we go.
Oh, God. Dr. LaPook, if you get the virus and recover, do you know yet if what a person can get it again? Does anyone know this?
Yeah.
That's one question. And then after you feel better and you're totally recovered, can you still spread the virus?
Oh, boy, that is two great questions. So the first one, we think we know the answer to. If it's behaving like other viruses, and the asterisk is, it's kind of a new virus, but if it behaves like other viruses, once you're immune, you should have some immunity. Once you are infected and you recover, you should have some immunity for several years and maybe longer, but that we have to test that out. In terms of how long you're infectious for, you know, what the current criteria is, after you feel better, and people should check on the CDC website, cdc.gov, but it's something like no fever for 3 days, it's been at least 7 days since your first symptoms, and you're getting better. You know, so no fever for 72 hours. But the question about whether you still have some virus in you remains to be studied. But for right now, the criteria are on the cdc.gov website. You know, if you do CDC space coronavirus, and then there's a whole section that talks about if you're sick and when you can go out and when you're considered under quarantine and not under quarantine. So there's a little bit of, you know, as there are with so many of these things, there's an asterisk to this. But those are two questions I'm hearing all the time. Kelly O'Hara, did you see yourself on CBS Sunday Morning?
Hold on, where is she? I don't know if she's still here. Kelly O'Hara, oh, there you are.
Did you see yourself on CBS?
Watching. You know what? I didn't see myself, but I heard about it from a lot of people. So that was really cool. I'm so glad. They burst it.
You were the big moment there with the voice. The whole
That's movie. Awesome. Thank you. Yeah. I still haven't seen it, but thank you. I'm glad to be.
Anyway, thank you for being part of that, because that was great, and it was talking about the importance of this and about staying together even as we're physically separated. So I take my hat off to all of you. If I had a hat, I would get a hat and then take it off. So you guys are great.
Kelly will be back. Better Than Buckley will be back for her full show. I guess we got to close with the Brian Stokes Mitchell song. So Dr. LaPook, I'll bring you back and say goodbye at the very end. And I'm going to bring on Mr. Brian Stokes Mitchell. Stokes, you still got the voce to sing a final song?
I still do, yeah. I'll do one last song. And just before I do, just something really, really quick. The other board that I'm a member of is called Americans for the Arts. It's a nonpartisan arts organization. And right now, with all the legislation that's coming up with the entire country, a lot of the issues have been that artists are kind of being moved to the side and not included in the legislature. But I just want to say, I was talking to one of the people from there today, and if you go to www.artsactionfund.org/action-center, it'll take you to a site that has a letter pre-written where you can find out who your congressmen, your senators are. You can send a pre-written letter. You can use the one that they have and send that in and let them know that, because it's for nonprofit and for-profit arts as well. But go on that site. There's a wealth of information on there. But I hope everybody does that as well. We all need to support each other in this time.
It's called Americans for the Arts.
Americans for the Arts, but it's www.artsactionfund.org. SiriusXM.org. And then you can see, it'll take you to the other /action-center on there as well. But or you could go to it straight for that. So I hope people will take some time, especially this week, because they're doing that right as we speak. Maybe they're still doing it. I don't know while we do the show. But, you know, next couple, 3 days, they're trying to make things happen. So let's use our American voices and speak up, because this is when they need to hear from us and say, right, you know, this is what we need.
All right, I'm leaving the screen to you.
All right. I'm going to close with this one. Hold on. My wife is trying to pass me a note, too. Let me see what she's saying.
Folks, your mic is a little hot, so you don't have to be as close. Just have
she said that was the first note she passed me. You're too close to the mic.
Allison, of course you did.
I will back off. Here, you can say.
I'm going to say this really quickly. Hi, everybody. Hi. Jumping on. Betty Buckley, thank you just for being you and showing up. God, I love you. Audra Mac, I have a couple notes for you. Bernard Datsun will be calling you about that exit. You may want to talk to him about it. Dr. Danielle Taylor has asked about your glasses, where you got them from.
Oh.
She wants to know. I know, right? Random. But it's she'll meet you there. Kelly O'Hare, keep tipping. You know what that means. And Seth and James, thank you. Thank you for bringing a community together. And giving us a place to be creative and make a difference. Also, one other thing, I'll do the political thing. On actorsequity.org is a opportunity for people to write to their electeds. Same with Screen Actors Guild. You don't have to be a member of any union to do it, but you raise your voice and help us out. And it's a fill-in letter, it's a pre-written letter, but numbers count, as Marty Bell said. So all the best. Everybody be well, be healthy. And don't forget, reach out and touch somebody socially responsibly, of course. and until we do, and I keep saying, when we finally do get to meet, and this is lifted, there are better days ahead of us. More of us survive this. Sorry, and thank you, Dr. LaPook. There are better days ahead of us. And when we finally see each other and get the opportunity to hug, we will really, really hug it out. Yeah. I love you all.
Oh, what a hug that will be.
Bye, Allison.
We're gonna give you the floor.
Thank you guys. Thank you again. I can't add to that. She said it really brilliantly and beautifully and much better than I can, like she pretty much does all the time. So I'm just gonna leave it at that. And thank you. Thank you guys. So I think I'm gonna close with the song that is the song that I get the most requests for of anything at all. And everybody knows it. It's The Impossible Dream. And I thought, should I sing that song? Because sometimes people have the wrong impression of what this song is. As Mitch Ali reminded me when I was doing the song, it's not really called The Impossible Dream. The song is called The Quest. It's not a song about trying to do something that's impossible. It's a song about trying, period, because we can't accomplish anything until we try. So just keep that in mind as you're listening to this song. And thank you, everybody who's out there right now, healthcare workers, Dr. John LaPook, everybody who's just trying to get us to the next step on this. Thank you so much. And this is Ted Firth is also playing on this one too, my pianist. And by the way, here's Ted. We're keeping our social distancing, but he's, like I said, my second brain, and I wanted to acknowledge him. He actually recorded this track for me today. We just talked on the phone. He said, hey, if there's anything ever you want me to play for you. I said, hey, I'm doing something tonight. Send me the track. So he sent me this track specially for this show. So thank you for that, Ted. All right. Let me get it going. To dream. The impossible dream. To fight the unbeatable foe. To bear with unbearable sorrow. To run where the brave dare not go. To ride the unrightable wrong. To love pure and chaste from afar. To try when your arms are too weary. To reach
the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star. No matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right, without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest. And the world will be better for this, that one man scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable stars. This is my quest, to follow that star. No matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the rights, without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest. And the world will be better for this, that one man scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable star. God bless everybody. Be safe.
That was amazing. Amazing.
Bravo.
Thank you. I was crying. I'm crying. Thank you.
Mitch Lee and Joe Darien for writing that, and Ted Firth for playing it.
Thank you. Well, we got to let the dogs out, as we always do at the end of our show.
Well, but except our doggy, during one of our dogs during that started limping. So we're going to do gonna it gently.
You remember Ash?
Come on, Lucas.
Come. Ash. You know, Barry Lynn has.
Here's Lucas. Come, Lucas. Come, Lucas. Come. Come. Can you see Lucas?
Hey, Lucas. Whoops. Lucas, this is Ash.
That was Max the dog.
Oh, Betty's dog.
And also Diggity Dog, who we also lost as well. But they're still in the
house. Broadway Barks babies.
Yeah.
Everyone. Jeremy Jordan for our matinee. And the evening show is
Raul Esparza.
Family chat.
And Ellington.
Love y'all. Amazing.
Be safe.
Well, be safe.
Thank you. Thank you.
And Rockham.
Thanks, Jay.